Good morning. Today I'll discuss about gastrointestinal stromal tumor difficulties and challenges. It can happen at any age, however, it's most common at around 60 years. It happens in older individual, however, if it happens in younger, then we need to see about syndromes. The most common sites are stomach, small intestine, and colon, followed by extraintestinal GIST. Unfortunately, the research on GIST in India has happened very less so far. So it's driven by activating mutation of KIT and PDGFRA, that is platelet derived growth factor. So this is their receptive tyrosine kinases, and these are various domains. This is extracellular domain, juxtamembrane domain. This is ATP binding and tyrosine and activation loop domain. And these are the exon 17 encodes it, exon 13 encodes it, exon 11. And so the most common in c-KIT is exon 11. The most common in PDGFRA is exon 18. These are the various mutations that happen in these domains. So I've divided my talk into few things. Adjuvant therapy, that is what kind of adjuvant therapy should be given post-surgery in order to decrease the recurrence. So what to understand what kind of therapy we need to give, we need to understand what are the chances of recurrence for a given patient and what does it depend upon. It depends on mitosis, the ability of cells to divide, the tumor size, the tumor site, if it is in stomach, small intestine, or elsewhere. Tumor rupture is very important prognostic factor. And as of now, the mutations are also extremely important and they must be done. If it is EGFR D842V in localized form, they have good prognosis. However, if it is metastatic, the median progression-free survival is only 2.8 months, unfortunately. So these are the mutations. Even if we know it is c-KIT exon 11 mutation, we must know if it is duplication because it offers favorable prognosis. If it is localized to codons 557 and 558, then the prognosis might not be great. In KIT exon 9, they carry unfavorable prognosis. Regarding SDH and NF1, I will further discuss in my talk. So to prognosticate in early 2000s, they came up with the NIH consensus criteria, which was based upon size and mitotic rate per 50 high power field. However, quite a few things were not included, including site, tumor rupture, and thus the need for other prognostic factor came. It was followed by AFIP scoring, which included the site of disease, however, rupture was not there. Simultaneously, if you see, this, the mitosis is not continuous. So that if a patient has 5 per 50 high power field and has ileal GIST, as compared to 6 per 50 high power field, the outcomes are disparate. That means only one increase in mitosis might lead to outcomes in 24% to 73%. This is the problem with dichotomous variables. So further to improve upon this, modified NIH criteria was given for to select the highest risk of disease. And in this high risk disease is the true high risk disease and any tumor rupture, any non-stomach, more than 10 centimeter, more than 10 per 50 high power mitosis field, or more than 5 in both. Again, in this context only, a newer prognostic factor came in 2012, which is known as contour mapping. So this study, which was published in Lancet in 2012, what they did, they pooled 2,900 patients, largest data ever, and they studied the prognostic factor, size, tumor size, mitotic count, tumor site. If you see, the stomach has best prognostic factor as compared to extraintestinal GIST, which is worst prognostic factor. And you can see the prognostic importance of tumor rupture. Those patients who had rupture had miserable outcome as compared to patients with no rupture. So this is the contour mapping. It is non-linear. The relation of mitotic count and tumor size to prognosis non-linear. That means if it is from 1 to 2, in early part, the prognostic prognosis is, it varies very like very rapidly. If it is 1 to 5, then the prognosis varies. However, in later part, if it's 15 or 20, the prognosis is important, it loses its importance. Thus, if it is 5, it is 1, it is 10, then it actually affects the prognosis. However, if it is 32 mitosis per 50 hyperfold as compared to 50, the prognosis will not vary much. Thus, these are non-linear variables. The only drug which has been approved in adjuvant setting is imatinib, the ideal duration of which is still not known. However, as of now, consensus is 3 years. The first trial, which was ECOSOC trial, gave 1 year versus no imatinib, that is placebo. They found recurrence-free survival benefit. However, there was no significant difference after 6 years of follow-up. And then the need for greater duration of imatinib rose. And as you can see, this is Scandinavian trial in which 3 years of imatinib was compared with 1 year of imatinib. And there was relapse-free survival benefit. Along with that, there was 10% overall survival benefit at 5 years. Again, as they saw, just after stopping imatinib after 3 years, majority of recurrences happened in both arms after 1 year and after 3 years. So perhaps the greater duration might give better results. And this is Scandinavian trial is going on, which is comparing 3 years versus 5 years. Again, a French trial is also going on, which will compare 3 years versus 6 years. So regarding 3 years versus 1 year, in last year only, the long-term outcomes have come, and this is recurrence-free survival. As you can see, the recurrence-free survival is even maintained at 10 years of follow-up. It's almost 50% in 36 months arm as compared to 40% in 12 months arm. And the survival benefit is also there. And this is 80% versus 65%, which is a significant improvement in survival. So recently someone called me up from Banaras that we had a patient of GIST with stomach GIST and the margins are positive. However, post-surgery, the PET CT was normal and it's 8 cm high mitotic count. So what should we do? Should we repeat surgery? What should we do? So there is a very good paper by Grohe et al. Which was came last year. And it says that perhaps the most important part after surgery is tumor rupture. If tumor rupture is there, this is a worst prognosis. However, R1 resection is perhaps not the poorest prognostic thing. And R1 resection might not have any effect on prognosis. So margin positive in GIST, it's okay unless or until residual disease is not there. There are few syndromes in which GIST happens. So it's a collection of various disease or malignancies. They are Carney's syndrome, which have 3 diseases, gastric GIST, periganglioma, and pulmonary chondroma. Other than this, these patients might have adrenal adenomas and esophageal leiomyomas. So the criteria for this Carney's triad is at least 2 malignancies, of which they are not gastric GIST and periganglioma because it fits into Carney's strategy syndrome. So Carney's strategy syndrome is diet of GIST and periganglioma. Another syndrome which is of very much importance is neurofibromatosis 1, which has a lot of malignancies, including optic nerve glioma, rhabdomyosarcoma, magnetic peripheral nerve sheath tumor, periganglioma, and wild type GIST. And they are often multicentric and located in small bowel, are usually spindle shaped. So I'll just tell about a case that we saw last year, 48-year-old gentleman who presented melena, upper GI endoscopy CSC of multiple stomach growths, could be gastric GIST. CT chest was done with CST of nodular opacities and could be pulmonary chondroma, and then surgery was done, biopsy was CST of SDHB deficiency, strongly suggestive, it came out to be GIST obviously, and the deficiency of SDHB CST or SDH deficient GIST, wild type GIST. So this is the during surgery pics, this is the lesion, there are 2 other lesions. So the surgeon asked us before surgery that what kind of surgery should be done. And we were discussing tumor board, that the surgery that needs to be done in wild type GIST is wedge resection. It has not to be anatomical resection, because whatever the data is, this is a, so in NIH, wild type GIST clinic was started in 2008, which is quite inspirational. And the data that suggests that EFS did not depend on the type of resection. So only the wedge resection for three lesions was done. Another case, 29-year-old lady, spindle type GIST, stomach, CKIT and PGFA negative. These are the cells, mostly spindle shape, fewer epithelioid shape, and SDHB was retained throughout the tumor. So the germline mutation was suggestive of neurofibromatosis. So this is kind of GIST, for which is 0.1% of all GIST, and it predominantly happens in females. The median age is younger, multifocal in 1/3 of patients. Stomach is hardly a site of GIST, but in our patient was stomach. Majority of them are spindle shaped, R was mixed. And in metastatic setting, they're not that indolent and they don't respond to TKIs. In this series, no one survived beyond 1 year and no one responded to sunitinib, imatinib or regorafenib. So this is all about GIST syndromes, metastasis. Yeah, so this is the setting in which a lot of advances happen over the years. In 2002, imatinib was approved. In 2020, two drugs were approved, avapritinib and ripretinib. We have come a long way, and other drugs which are effective are bezopenib, cabozantinib, ponatinib, a bit of immunotherapy, temozolomide, and MEK inhibitors. So in metastatic setting, imatinib on an average gives median PFS of 2 years and median overall survival of 5 to 6 years. However, there is no difference between 400 mg once a day or 400 mg twice a day. Many times people ask that what should be done if patient progresses on 400 mg? Should we escalate it or should we switch over? So the data for which is very less, European guidelines suggested in 2018 that yes, it could be escalated. However, there is a paper in which was published in 2005, which was analysis of 133 patients of URTC trial who were crossover from 400 mg progression to 800 mg. Partial response was only 2%. Stable disease for 2-3 months was almost 27%. The median PFS was not very high. It was only 81 days. Thus, the benefit of crossing over is not very significant, hardly 3 months or less than 3 months. Perhaps in the current situation when we have great second line, third line, and now ripretinib has come, we avoid crossing over unless the patient has some limitations or unless the patient has exon 9 or some, or the ripretinib and other drugs are not available, or else right now escalation has very less role. So now the next drug which was approved after imatinib was sunitinib. It was studied in second line, again placebo controlled trial, phase 3 trial, parallel group. The primary endpoint was tumor time to progression, and as you can see, the curves are diverging. And the time to progression sunitinib arm was 27 weeks as compared to 6 weeks in placebo, and hazard ratio is 0.33, which is great. And the dose of sunitinib used in this trial was 50 mg once a day for 4 weeks, followed by 2 weeks gap, which is a difficult dose to give in, especially patients who have comorbidities or elderly. So they came out with another phase 2 trial in which the continuous daily dosing of 37.5 mg was found to be better tolerated. And the effectiveness was still there for a single arm trial, not a comparative trial, but still median EFS was 34 weeks. Third line drug is regorafenib, which is again primary end was progression free survival. So this is the curve. The outcome was 4 months PFS versus 0.9 month PFS, which is statistically quite significant. Due to crossover, the survival benefit was not there. So in GRID study, the study I've discussed about regorafenib, 70% of patients could not have 160 mg per day of regorafenib. And while the resting period, 26% of patient exacerbation of symptoms. So again, a low dose continuous drug dose was tried. This is the phase 2 Korean trial in which they could give it 100 mg once a day, and the median PFS was still 7.3 months. This is the dose we try in our clinics, and it is quite effective. So the newest drugs which have been approved is avapritinib, which is a PDGFR842 specific drug. This mutation is mostly localized to stomach. So before this drug came, the outcome in patients with advanced setting in this mutation subtype was very dismal, 2.8 months. Imatinib refractory mutation. So this is this drug was approved based upon phase one trial. There were two parts, dose escalation part in which maximum tolerated dose and recommended phase two dose and safety was studied. Second was dose expansion part in which overall response was studied. And this is the waterfall plot in 56 patients, almost 55 patients had clinical benefit. This is superb and dramatic. The progression-free survival, 12 months, 81% of patients were progression-free. And the median progression-free survival was 34 months. So this is our experience. We gave it to 5 patients. There was PR in 3 out of 5 patients, partial response. Median progression happened after 6 months. So this is a patient with D842 mutation, stomach, progressed on imatinib. This is the disease. After 3 months of avapritinib, patient has partial response, and this is after 9 months of avapritinib. This is after 1 year, complete response. However, it comes with few toxicities. Again, in our paper, we could see few these toxicities in which graying of hair is there. Periorbital edema is much more than imatinib. Some patients have pleural effusion, and the most dreaded toxicity is subdural hemorrhage, which happened in one of our patients. Other than this, cognitive abnormalities are very common, happen in 40% of patients. One of our patients is still having cognitive abnormalities. So this is a pleural effusion in one of our patients. This is a subdural hemorrhage. For regarding cognitive abnormality, one of our patients has the workup is going on, and it has led to dose reduction. So another drug which was approved in late 20 is ripretinib, which is approved now in fourth line drug. After imatinib, sunitinib, and regorafenib, the response rate is 9% based upon Invictus trial, small trial, not a very big trial, placebo control again, for which it was criticized. And as you see, the progression-free survival in fourth line is great, 6.3 months versus 1 month, which might be actually better than sunitinib or regorafenib, and that's why it's positioned now second or third line setting. This is the overall survival, which is the hazard ratio is again worth noticing, 0.36. So this is one of our patients who had cervical metastasis, extensive liver metastasis, abdominal disease, bony metastasis. This is after 3 months of ripretinib. So this drug has great activity, and I think it's an exciting time for the GIST community that such drugs are there available, and especially in India when we can access them through compassion-based program. The most intriguing subtype of GIST is wild type GIST, and it's very important to learn that a lot of our patients come with wild type GIST, and we don't know why wild type GIST is higher in our patients. First step is to make sure it is wild type, because many times these mutations are missed. They're cryptic mutations. So a deeper sequencing has shown to reveal another c-kit mutation or PDGFR mutation in 20-30% of cases in wild type. We need to classify this wild type GIST into BRAF, into SDH, NF, FGFR, or NTRK. In metastatic setting, it is totally individualized or personalized based upon the mutations. And the breakthrough in wild type GIST is still awaited. But till now, the diagnosis has evolved. At first, wild type GIST is there. We need to have SDH immunochemistry. If it is positive, then it is not SDH deficient. And then NF1 should be done. If it is NF negative, then BRAF, RAS, and others should be done. If it is SDH deficient, then we should rule out SDH mutation or SDH epimutation, that is promoter hypermethylation. So I'll just tell about one of our patients of the therapeutic strategies in SDH tumors that are coming up. This was a 31-year-old young lady, post partial gastrectomy, multiple tumors in stomach. Again, recurrence in stomach, as you can see. And this is a progression over imatinib and sunitinib. This is the lymph node, which is very much indicative of SDH GIST, because it doesn't happen in normal GIST. So this is the lymph node. This is the SDH IHC, which is negative. These are the control cells in which HGH-IHC is positive. As you can see, this is epithelioid GIST. This is there, the spindling is absent categorically. And patient was started on temozolomide based upon the methylation, extensive methylation they inhibit, show. And this is the kind of response. Patient had partial response after temozolomide after 7 months. It's in publication. So another thing that has come out in GIST is in TRK mutations, and it is recommended in inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor, infantile fibrosarcoma. However, in wild type GIST also, if everything is negative, it is metastatic setting, it is good to rule out pan-TRK-IHC. If it is positive, then massive parallel sequencing needs to be done. And if positive, then larotrectinib and entrectinib might have great activity in this subtype. So there are quite a few things that we need to improve in India. The prospective need of prospective studies, the quality of mutation testing and in-house mutation testing in all the institutions. We need to encourage clinical trial about these rare diseases, more publications and awareness and enthusiasm among doctors. Collaboration and focus is the key to everything. And we need to soon have a GIST database and registry. And we need to sort out this extremely heterogeneous subtype, which is wild type GIST. And I think if these guys can push the boundaries, why can't we? Thank you.